last video we had seen what were the various criteria to explain the five kingdom classification, right? So today we will take only one kingdom and try to learn the various salient features. So kingdom Monera, the sole members of this kingdom are bacteria. They are also called as the kingdom of prokaryotes. What do we mean by prokaryotes? Organisms which do not have proper nuclear membrane surrounding the genetic material, right? So, since these organisms are primitive ones, they are found everywhere. Even the teaspoonful of soil, if we take and analyze under microscope, we will see thousands of such bacteria in that soil. Okay? Since they are the primitive organism, this kingdom is also called as prokaryota. Okay? And we know that all the prokaryotes are included in kingdom Monera. Okay, and they all are unicellular organisms, right? And they are microscopic in nature. Through our naked eye, we cannot see these organisms. Okay, so we will see each and every feature of these monads. So monads means single cell. So therefore, they are unicellular. But these organisms can also present in the form of colony. Okay? Prokaryotic, we have discussed already that the genetic material is naked here and it doesn't surround with the nuclear membrane. Therefore, this structure is called as nucleoid and not the nucleus. Also, this DNA do not have any proteins, histone proteins, which will give it a particular structure. Usually in eukaryotic organism, the DNA is like a woolen ball, and that is because of histone proteins. So these proteins will help to this DNA to get a compact structure like a woolen ball. DNA will get wrapped around these proteins. So therefore we see the DNA as a bead structure compactly arranged in the nucleus of eukaryotic cell. But such histone proteins are absent in the DNA of the prokaryotic organism. And the DNA is the naked one without the nuclear membrane. As I already discussed, that since these organisms are the primitive one, therefore they will be present in soil or it may be in the human being. They can be also present in plants, also in the animals, and also in the harsh, unfavorable condition, for example in icebergs, or in hot springs, or wherever there is hot desert, these organisms are able to thrive themselves in any type of environmental conditions. Okay? So, they have various kinds of shapes. The shapes are spherical or ovoid shape of structure. Second one is rod shaped structure, also called as bacilli. Third one is comma shaped, also called as vibrio. They are always single in nature. Okay? So they are not aggregated together. Then the spiral one are called as spirilla. So they have spiral shaped structure. Like vibrio, they also do not aggregate together. Okay? They can be either heterotrophic or autotrophic. We know that autotrophs are those which will prepare their own food. Heterotrophic are those which will depend on the other organism. They cannot prepare their own food. Okay? Autotrophic is either photosynthetic type or chemosynthetic type. Okay, this also we had discussed. Then heterotrophic can be either parasitic or saprophytic. Parasitic organisms are those which will take the nutrition, okay, from the host, and it is harmful for that host, right? But they will survive. Saprophytic are those which will live on the decayed organic matter, and they will try to decompose this matter, right? So these both are what? The holophytic mode of nutrition which they are having. Okay, there is another type called a symbiotic mode of nutrition, wherein there will be beneficial mutual relationship between the two organisms. That means they will draw the nutrition, take help from each other, and both will survive. Most of the organisms are very good decomposers, so they will help in mineralization in the soil, and also they can produce antibiotics too. So kingdom Monera is divided into two categories, Archaebacteria and Eubacteria. Archaebacteria are also called as the ancient bacteria. It indicates that these organisms were the first one to evolve, and then these gave rise to Eubacteria, which is also called as true bacteria. Okay? There are other two forms coming under kingdom Monera, that is Mycoplasma and Actinomycetes. Archaebacteria are the ancient bacteria having the cell structure little different from that of true bacteria. Okay? So, these cells are surrounded by the cell wall, which is the protective covering for these cells. Cell wall are present in most of the organism. So here the cell wall in the true bacteria usually have peptidoglycan, having amino acid and sugar chains in them. Okay? So these are the molecules that are present in peptidoglycan. So in all true bacteria, there is the presence of peptidoglycan. Since these are the ancient bacteria, they have proteins and non-cellulosic polysaccharides are present. That means polysaccharides are the sugar molecules, but they are non-cellulosic. Also, we should remember all the bacteria, whether it is true bacteria or archaebacteria, they all are non-cellular or non-cellulosic type of cell wall which they have. That means most of the organism, they have cellulose in their cell wall. Whereas in such bacteria, there is the absence of cellulose. So therefore, these organisms are also called as non-cellulosic or non-cellular type of organisms. Okay? So we should remember in archaebacteria, there is the presence of protein and non-cellulosic polysaccharides instead of peptidoglycan. Okay? Cell membrane is made up of lipid chain in these organisms. Archaebacteria are the one which can survive in any harsh condition. It may be hot springs, it may be extreme salty areas, or it can be in the wetlands, or we can say marshy areas. Okay? So therefore, based on the habitat of where these organisms are living, they are of three types. That is, in extreme salty areas are called as halophytes. Okay? Halophytes. These organisms are called as halophytes. Hot springs are called as thermoacidophytes. thermoacidic when we speak about, that means they can survive any high temperature and also in the acidic condition too. So they are thermoacidophiles. And marshy areas, the organisms are called as methanogens. Okay, they are called as methanogens. So based on their habitat, we can categorize Archaebacteria into three types: halophiles, thermoacidophiles, and methanogens. That is salty areas, hot springs, okay, or in the marshy areas. Methanogens play very important role not only in the cattle or ruminating animals but also to the environment. It is also beneficial for us too. Okay? Methanogens are present in the first chamber of the stomach of the cattle, wherein fermentation of cellulosic material that will take place inside the stomach or rumen. The part of stomach where these methanogens are present are called as rumen. Okay? So they will carry out the fermentation of cellulose which they take. So therefore these cattle will release methane gas in the environment. So they are present in the gut of these ruminant animals and they will produce the biogas. And we know that biogas is being utilized not only for the electricity but for cooking too. Okay? So from the dung of these animals, biogas can be released, okay, through fermentation. So we know that once the digestion of these cellulose will take place, they will release the gas in the form of methane into the environment. The next type is eubacteria or true bacteria. These organisms have rigid cell wall, okay, and as we have discussed, the cell wall have peptidoglycan. Okay, some members of these eubacteria have flagella, and that is meant for motility or movement from one place to another. Okay, we have already understood about the nucleoid. Okay, cell wall, as I said, they are non-cellular or non-cellulosic since they devoid cellulose, but they have peptidoglycan. Membrane-bound organelles are also absent in prokaryotic organism. Cytoplasm, it is the thick fluid that is present and it will be surrounded by the plasma membrane. Okay, and this plasma membrane is selectively permeable membrane, so it will select only those ions to come in or out of the cell. Now they are having some bristle like structures are useful for reproduction. We'll see that in detail further. Then the flagella is also a protoplasmic appendages which comes out from the cell wall and it is meant for locomotion, also to gather food, and they have some sense organ which will sense the environment. Okay, flagella can be either single or they will be in the like the form of tuft of flagella, a group of flagella that will arise from these organs, or the whole surface will be surrounded by flagella. So it depends what type of bacteria it is. So eubacteria is divided into three types: photosynthetic, chemosynthetic, and heterotrophic. So the first one is photosynthetic autotrophic bacteria, also called as cyanobacteria. We call these organisms as blue-green algae because of the presence of the chlorophyll pigment in them. Okay? In any stagnant water, we can see these patches of blue-green algae. So cyanobacteria, as the name says, cyanobacteria, that is, it has a pigment called as cyanophycin. So that cyanophycin will give blue color, and also it will have chlorophyll A, which is similar to green plants. Now the question arises, if they are like green plants, why these organisms are kept under kingdom Monera? It is because of the characteristic which they have. They are prokaryotic forms. So they are present in the fresh water or in marine forms, or they can be also present in the terrestrial. Okay, but there some water should be there, because water play very important role for the multiplication of these algae. Okay, so they can be terrestrial, fresh water or marine forms. They often form the blooms, and it will pollute the water bodies. It will trap all the solar energy for photosynthesis, and it won't allow that solar energy to go inside deep into the water. So therefore, the organisms that are present inside in the water won't survive. Okay, so it will pollute the water bodies. Cell structure. These blue-green algae can be unicellular, or they can be in the form of colony. Okay, wherever there is moist condition during rainy season, we usually see certain patches. Under microscope, you'll be able to see the proper colonies of these organisms. They are also in the form of filamentous. So they are in the form of chain. So we call these as filaments. And also they are surrounded by the gelatinous sheath. Okay? To make them as a colonial form. Okay? So they can be all are unicellular, but they can be filamentous or in the form of colony, or they will be separated from each other. Some of these organisms, for example Nostoc and Anarina, can fix the atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into some other form. For example, ammonia, okay, which is essential to carry out the metabolic activities. Specialized cells, heterocysts, will help in nitrogen fixation into ammonia. Okay. The second type of true bacteria are chemosynthetic autotrophic bacteria. As we know, chemosynthetic means they will take the energy through some chemical reaction and they will prepare their own food. So here, the inorganic substance that are present in the environment, say nitrates, nitrites or ammonia, these inorganic substances will carry out certain chemical reaction, that is oxidation of these inorganic substance will take place, and they will release the energy. The released energy is taken by these bacteria and they will prepare their food, as well as they will release the energy too. Okay, so they play important role in recycling the nutrients, for example nitrogen, phosphorus, iron or sulfur, since the chemical reactions are taking place here. Okay. The third type is heterotrophic bacteria. As the name says, heterotrophic, they cannot prepare their own food, right? So they are dependent on the other organisms. So they are most abundant in nature, and the majority of these organisms are decomposers. Okay? As the name says, decomposers, that means they survive on the decayed material, right? Dead organisms. Heterotrophic bacteria are again of three kinds. Saprophytic. Saprophytic are those organisms which will live on the dead organic matter. Symbiotic, wherein they will have beneficial mutualism relationship. And and parasitic bacteria which live on other living organisms. So, saprophytic bacteria can be either useful or harmful. Symbiotic bacteria are beneficial for both the organism. They will help each other. And parasitic bacteria are harmful for the other organisms. Okay? So, saprophytic bacteria help in curdling of milk, preparation of butter, mineralization. Since they carry out decomposition, they will add minerals to the soil. And also, they will carry out decomposition by breaking down the major organic material into simpler forms. Also, they are very much beneficial in the production of alcohol, vitamins, that is through fermentation alcohol can be produced, then vitamins, enzymes and also the antibiotics. Okay. Now, how they are harmful? It will spoil the food material. Deterioration of the household articles are due to these bacteria. The saprophytic bacteria producing antibiotics are grouped in actinomycetes. Antibiotics such as streptomycin, erythromycin are produced by these organisms. They also play important role in soil decomposition. Okay? And these antibiotics are very much essential for us. Next is symbiotic bacteria. Example, rhizobium. Rhizobium are the bacteria that are present in the root nodules. Okay? So, root nodules are present in most of the pulses. Soya bean if we take, okay, peas, family members if we take, they all have these nodules. So, they have symbiotic association with the roots. They will take the nutrition from the plant and also these organisms will help in the nitrogen fixation and it will provide the nourishment to the plant. So, both are beneficial for each other. Okay? So, they help in nitrogen fixation. Another example is E. coli bacteria that is present in the intestine of us. These organisms will take the nourishment from the intestinal juice and also these bacteria will release vitamin K, vitamin B for us. Next is parasitic bacteria which are harmful for the host. Okay, they will survive but they won't allow the host to survive since it draws all the nutrition from the host. So, they are also called as pathogenic bacteria. For example, pneumonia, cholera, TB, leprosy, tetanus, diphtheria, typhoid are the major diseases which we see in human beings. Reproduction in the bacteria is of two kinds, asexual and sexual. Asexual type of reproduction wherein the organism will multiply in such a way that it will give from each cell two daughter cells will be formed of their own kind. The organisms or daughter organisms which will be formed from these parental cell will be exactly similar. Okay? So, the DNA or genetic material will get duplicated first, get separated and the daughter cells will be formed. Okay? So, that is called as binary fission since two cells are formed here. Bi means two. Okay? And the process is called as fission. And this occurs during favorable condition. Under unfavorable condition, same bacteria will produce certain spores, okay, inside them. And these spores will get dispersed through air current. And during favorable condition, the bacteria will be released from the spore. So, this spore have outer covering which will protect it from the adverse condition. Sexual reproduction is also called as conjugation. There are no gametes as such here, male gamete or female gamete. But there is some gene recombination which takes place between the two cells. So therefore, the organism which will be formed here will be different from that of parental one. So here, reproduction will be adopted by primitive DNA that is present in one organism, it will transfer to the other organism. Okay? So for this, pilus or pili play very important role. We should recall that the bacteria have small bristle-like structure which we had discussed earlier. They will form the cytoplasmic bridge. So we see here that is the cytoplasmic bridge which will be formed here because of pilus, and then the gene recombination will take place and it will be donated to the other bacteria. Mycoplasma are the other type of organisms coming under kingdom Monera. Mycoplasma are also called as PPLO. Okay, that is pleuro pneumonia like organisms. Okay, now these organisms are little different from that of other bacteria. They lack completely the cell wall, whereas we had learned that the other bacteria, they have cell wall. Okay, so they are devoid of cell wall and therefore they can attain any type of shape. Okay, these organisms are the smallest living cells which are known. Okay, and they can survive in anaerobic condition, that is without oxygen too, these organisms can survive. Okay, they are, most of the organisms are pathogenic, that means what, they are parasitic in nature and it will kill the organism, other organism. Okay, so they are pathogenic in animals and plants. Okay, giving rise to disease called as pleuropneumonia, and therefore they are named as pleuropneumonia like organisms. Okay, so that was all about kingdom Monera, wherein we have discussed about two types and their forms. Okay, I hope you all have understood kingdom Monera. In the next class we will be discussing the second kingdom, kingdom Protista. Okay, thank you.